Good morning, everyone. I hope you are all feeling blessed and ready to receive God's word today. I'm Kelly Bradbury, the church chair, and on behalf of Trinity and Pastor Tom, who's on vacation this week, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to each and every one of you. Whether you're here for the first time or you're a regular attendee, your presence here is a gift, and we are thrilled to have you with us. We welcome back our friend and guest preacher, Reverend Dr. Carol Nurin. We are blessed to have her lead us in a worship and bring the word of God today. So thank you for being here, Carol. As we gather together in worship, let us open our hearts and minds to the grace and love of God. This is a time for community, for worship, and for drawing closer to Jesus. Now let's please stand and join together in the call to worship. Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. God changes times and seasons, sets up kings and disposes them. God gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning, reveals deep and hidden things. God knows what lies in darkness. Light dwells in all of them.
For the glory of the sky. us pray. Almighty God, you have given your Son to be for us a sacrifice for sin and also an example of godly life. Give us grace to receive thankfully the fruits of his redeeming work and to follow daily in the blessed steps of his most holy life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Once again, good morning. We're glad that you're here. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we ask you to fill out the blue Connect card in the pew, and you can drop it in the box at the back of the church. As well as those of you online, there's a Connect card online if you can fill that in as well. If you have any special prayer concerns, there's a yellow card in the pew that you can fill out and put in the box at the back. And I also ask you to pass the black book. A lot of directions there. All right, just a few announcements. Just a reminder, we're almost home collecting tuna, cans of tuna. There are some boxes in the narthex for you to put those in. A reminder that there is no Bible study this week. It will resume next Wednesday because Pastor Tom and Amy are on vacation. Hopefully they're having a nice time, relaxing. Also, remember that if you're calling the office, we do not have someone in there answering the phones every day. Please give some time for a phone call back or call someone that you know can maybe answer your question instead of the office. So just for a time period. Thank you for that. Now is the time to pass the peace of Christ to one another. As Jesus welcomed everyone with love and peace, let's do the same. Let us open our hearts and welcome each other.
It's now time for our morning offering, the post-COVID version, I understand. You may leave your offerings in the box that is in the back of the church, or you may mail them to the church office, or I think you can also donate online, can't you? So let's take a few moments as we hear the organ solo to offer our hearts as well as our resources to God.
Thank you.
may be seated. For our prayers of the people this morning, I would appreciate it if you would do a responsive prayer with me. I will lift up a petition, and when I say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond, hear our prayer. That makes it feel more corporate to me, as though we're all praying together. Let us bow our heads in prayer. We thank you, God, Heavenly Father, source of all mercies, for the gift of this day, for the opportunity to gather in your house once again with brothers and sisters in Christ. We thank you for all that this church means to us and has meant to those who have gone before us. And we give you thanks for those who have nurtured us in the Christian faith. We pray your blessing on the ministry and outreach of this congregation, for the leaders of the church, both lay and clergy, that in all things your Son Jesus Christ may be glorified. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We come before you this morning, Lord, most of us with people from whom we are estranged or toward whom we nurture hard feelings. Those who have hurt us in one way or another, those who have neglected us, those who have let us down, whether at work or in a family situation or at a governmental level. Lord, soften our hardness of heart. Help us to hold fast to your truth, but not to grudges. Let your Son be made known through the way we deal with one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our president and all those in authority, for the leaders of the nations, for the leaders of our country and this state, this county and this town. Lord, let there be justice and peace on the earth. Give us a desire to fulfill your purpose in our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those we know and those we do not know who have special needs, whether because of illness or bereavement or other crisis. Hear us as we lift up Tom and Oren, Terrell and Sandy, Priscilla, Grace, Larry, Pat, Edward, Dorothy, Karen, Bertha, Nels, Carol and Jim, Mel, Roberta, Janice, Santa, Carol, Kyle, Craig. For those who may be going through very difficult times emotionally or spiritually, for those concerns that we dare not speak aloud, Lord, in your mercy. And we pray for ourselves, Lord, that you would fill us with your Spirit and equip us to do the work you have called us to do. Help us to be faithful. Help us to be sensitive to the leading of your Spirit. Help us to radiate Christ to all we see. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For your is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's first scripture reading comes from Mark 3, verses 20 through 35. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, "He is out of his mind." And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebul, by the prince of demons. He is driving out demons." So Jesus called them over to him and began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly, I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of an eternal sin. He said this because they were saying he was an impure spirit. Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." Our next reading comes from 1 Timothy 1, verses 8 through 17. We know that the law is good if one uses it properly. We also know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for lawbreakers and rebels, the ungodly and sinful, the unholy and irreligious, for those who kill their mothers or fathers, for murderers, for the sexually immoral, for those practicing homosexuality, for slave traders and liars and perjurers, and for whoever else is contrary to the sound doctrine that conforms to the gospel concerning the glory of the blessed God, which he entrusted to me. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I'm grateful for the opportunity to preach here again at Trinity Covenant Church. It's hard for me to believe that it is almost 40 years since my brother Dave and my parents first began attending here and I began visiting. And you have been most hospitable in inviting me to preach on a number of occasions, so I'm thankful to you and to Pastor Tom for this opportunity. I'm aware that Pastor Tom has been leading you through a new series on Sunday morning and Bible study called New Frontiers, and that I think you're basically working your way through the book of Acts. And some of you may be wondering, so Carol, why aren't you working your way through the book of Acts? Two reasons for this. I didn't want to repeat something you may already have heard from Pastor Tom or steal his thunder from something that's coming up or try to address the theme and fail miserably. But the second reason is the text that you have heard are those that are suggested for this Sunday in the Revised Common Lectionary. For those of you not familiar, the lectionary is like a three-year calendar of readings, Old Testament, New Testament, and Gospel, on a cyclical basis that will take a congregation through the salvation history, the story of Jesus Christ, on an annual basis. It has the advantage of taking people through the whole Bible over the course of the 3 years and not gravitating towards those themes and texts that we're comfortable with, something that tempts every preacher. And as an added bonus for you in the congregation, because it is the common lectionary, that is, it's shared by most mainline Protestant churches, when you go to lunch at the diner after church and you meet friends from another church, you can talk about the sermon together, even though you heard two different messages. Over the years, I have been surprised. I have found it remarkable how frequently the lectionary text, the suggested readings for the day, address current events in the world around us. For example, and I remember these because I had to preach these Sundays, in 1974, all the president's men, the report on the Watergate scandal came out. The Watergate scandal, of course, led to President Nixon's resignation. The gospel reading for that Sunday was from Matthew 9, and Jesus, looking on them, had compassion because they were like sheep without a shepherd. In 1998, after the Starr report came out documenting then President Clinton's affair with Monica Lewinsky, the appointed text for the Sunday following was from Luke 15 about a sheep that had gone astray and the good shepherd going to find it and the joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. And the Sunday after September 11th, the Old Testament reading was the prophet Jeremiah lamenting over the cities in ruin. I think the Holy Spirit is at work in all this. In today's gospel reading, the verses that jumped out at me were, "A kingdom divided against itself cannot stand, and if a house is divided against itself, it cannot stand." Our families, our social media accounts, our country, our world feel like a house divided these days. Last weekend, I had a dinner party, and I did something I've never done before. When the first two guests arrived, I said, "All right, we have one house rule tonight. We're not discussing current events." They said, "Sounds good to us." And the other guests fell in line with it, and we all stayed away from hot topics and had a good time. You know what some of those hot topics are and how divisive they are among us as a people. In the last week or so, we have been inundated with stories about the current death toll in Gaza, the conviction of former President Trump, the disruption of graduation ceremonies by pro-Palestinian demonstrators, Hunter Biden's trial, the most recent mass shooting, which was in Akron, Ohio, the latest in the immigration crisis. The list of divisive topics is long. And in reporting the current news, mass media rarely quote scripture. They certainly don't look to the Revised Common Lectionary or consider it an authority, but there is nevertheless a ratings game going on. An implicit value judgment weighing the seriousness of one sin or violation of conventional mores against another. Who's most to blame for what's happening in the Middle East? Is it Hamas for the attack and the kidnapping on October 7th and using civilians as human shields? Or is it Israel for the continued shelling of Gaza? Is an alleged affair more or less serious than an alleged payment of hush money? And how do these compare with the alleged blackmail of a presidential candidate? Which is worse, a suburban mayor diverting public funds for personal use, or a president's son indicted for multiple firearms and tax evasion felonies? And a mass shooting, well, that has to be an 8 or a 9 at least, doesn't it? If we look at the gospel reading for this morning, we see a similar sort of rating system at work. Like this week's top news stories, the third chapter of Mark is full of accusations, pronouncements, questions about the gravity of one supposed infraction of the law against another. If we had started at the beginning of the first chapter of Mark, you would have heard about Jesus healing the hand of a withered man. But because he did so on the Sabbath, this was controversial. Then he called his disciples. He was casting out demons. And scene in 20 to 35 opens with two negative value judgments. The crowd that followed Jesus home was spreading rumors that he was beside himself, a polite way of saying, the man's nuts. He's out of control. His family, who loved him in spite of granting this rumor some credibility, went out hoping to seize him, an attempt at damage control. The Jewish authorities sent some investigative reporters to cover the story, and their technique was worthy of any tabloid. They got the audience worked up, saying, this man is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of demons, he casts out demons. This was a charge not to be taken lightly. Jesus responded by showing them how illogical and ridiculous this charge is. And that's where the statement about a house divided against itself cannot stand comes in. He, that is Jesus, could not be in league with the devil because Satan would not cast out Satan. And then our Lord raised the stakes. He announced, what's worse than breaking the Sabbath? What's worse than accusing someone of being out of his mind or misunderstanding his ministry? What has eternal implications beyond any other sin? On a scale from 1 to 10, blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is the 10. No one had an answer for this. Perhaps they didn't understand it. It's hard enough for us. Blasphemy is not a word that we encounter in everyday conversation, is it? So, what is this sin that rates a 10? The best explanation I have heard is it's being confronted by God at work in the world, most especially in the person of Jesus Christ, his Son, and then daring to say, nope, that's not God. That must be the devil. It's standing before the mercy and goodness of Jesus, knowing what and whom you see, and then turning your back and heading the other way. In today's gospel, the scribes were guilty of this terrible sin. Their attitude toward Jesus was, we don't want you. We don't need you. We're going to get you. They might not have recognized that Jesus was the Messiah, but they did know the good things that he said and did. And they were saying, mm-mm, that's not from God, that's Satan. The Master's words about the unforgivable sin are a warning of our peril if we persist in hostility toward the power of God manifest in him. And make no mistake, he was not threatening the scribes. We warn people of danger if we care about them. It's really the compassion of Christ extended even to those who were declaring war on him. Well, it would seem that nobody here in church this morning is likely to commit the unforgivable sin. On a scale from 1 to 10, we're not apt to pull a 10. We're not like them. We don't blaspheme against the Holy Spirit, do we? Or would we know if we did? As a culture, we have largely abandoned the concept of sin and personal culpability. We have no-fault divorces, as though marriages mysteriously disintegrate on their own. When a public official is caught in obvious violation of the law, the most that's ever said is, well, mistakes were made, as though they happened without human agency, like spontaneous combustion. We live in the most litigious nation on earth. And when we are confronted with the consequences of our actions, we're certain someone else is to blame. Someone else is responsible. It's the tobacco companies, the owner of the store, the 1%, medical malpractice, bad cops. We're not looking for a savior. We want a lawyer. Even in the church, we share the resistance of the scribes to acknowledge Jesus as healer, exorcist, and redeemer because it suggests we need him to be those things for us. And that's rather depressing for us. The prayer of confession is the most endangered species in most of Protestant worship, and even here at Trinity, unless it's Communion Sunday. In many mainline churches I visit, the prayer of confession has been replaced by a prayer of reconciliation. It consists of sharing our feelings with God, telling him what sort of week we've had, and saying we're glad to be reminded that God is with us. There's no reconciliation here because there is no acknowledgement of the sin that caused the estrangement. Such self-affirming, I'm okay, you're okay sentiment denies the truth of who we are and rejects the nature and work of the Messiah. For as it says in 1 Timothy, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Let me put it to you another way. Several years ago, I developed a pain in my left shoulder now and then. I didn't pay much attention to it. I was busy. And it didn't hurt all the time. Aspirin seemed to help. Everybody has aches and pains now and then, especially as you get older. But it didn't go away. It began to be stiff as well as sore. I did nothing. When it got bad enough that I could hardly put my coat on, I finally sought medical attention. The doctor did not turn me away. He didn't say, I haven't seen you in a long time. You're no longer my patient. No. I had minor surgery followed by physical therapy, and I'm better now. If I had insisted that my problem was only a 2 or 3 compared to people with more serious conditions, 9s or 10s, I could have lost the use of this arm. If we look at the list of offenses in 1 Timothy, lawlessness and disobedience, murder, kidnapping, sexual deviancy and promiscuity, lying and perjury, and then start rating our sins and say, on a scale of 1 to 10, mine are nothing. We're saying to Jesus, if your whole point in coming was to save people from sin, you didn't do that much for me. But as the writer of 1 John says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. You see, in the eternal scheme of things, we need healing and forgiveness through Jesus Christ no less than the scribes did, no less than the man with the withered hand, no less than those pursued and possessed by demons, no less than the person responsible for a mass shooting. The good news is that God's mercy has no limits. His grace is greater than all our sin. There is no person who is beyond restoration. No wrongdoing that will make him give up on us. No sin or situation that place us beyond his care. Only we can refuse or deny his mercy and power. To anyone seeking pardon, whether it's Donald Trump, Stormy Daniels, Hunter Biden, a Hamas militant, an Israeli soldier, Carol Noren, or any one of you, Jesus Christ can forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So boundless is our Savior's love that it cannot be measured on a scale from 1 to 10. Amen. Let us stand and sing together, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less."
The solid rock I stand, all other
now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Christ Jesus our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Nice job. Sounds beautiful.